Listener discretion is advised. Adam Carolla.
Where's Dr. True?
Loveline, coast to coast.
Hey, everybody, it's Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. Not Dr. Drew. Dr. Bruce, everybody. Filling in for Dr. Drew one more time.
That's forever? One more time?
Well, one more time this week, and then Dr. Drew back tomorrow night. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Dr. Bruce, board-certified physician, addiction medicine specialist, and an emergency ER doctor as well. Oh, yes. Probably much more qualified than Dr. Drew. It's just, you know, Dr. Drew has what we call it.
Presence.
You know what I'm saying? And he really doesn't have much it either. Thank you, Anderson. Thank you for correcting that sound that was in my head. But you, my friend, and let me say this about Dr. Bruce, and I don't mind this. I've said it many times. Dr. Bruce wanted to come in and film the show tonight. He brought it up last night. I was sort of crabby about the whole thing because I hadn't had much sleep. But he brings a nice big cup of Starbucks coffee, and he brings a nice big tub of dippity-doo to put in his hair because you know how I like you when you put gel in your hair.
I can't do the show without it.
Right. Dr. Bruce, everyone, is a new man when he puts gel in his hair. When he goes with the dry look, it's like the old, it's the spazzy, unconfident Dr. Bruce.
Dr. Spaz.
Dr. Spaz from high school. But when he slicks his hair back, all of a sudden he's Aldo Celli. He's a big star. And he looks good. That's right.
Renews your confidence.
All right. All right. But you know what? I'm going to get mad at you if you put another sweet low in that coffee.
Okay. I usually put, eight.
Yeah, eight sweet. That's
coffee.
Too many. No. That is too many.
Okay.
One sweet and low, and already you can start tasting the sweet and low. Not just the sweetness. You taste the low part.
No, that's a genetic...
Listen to me. One sweet and low, you taste the sweet. Two sweet and lows, you taste the low.
No, that's with equal. Not sweet and low.
One equal, you taste the eek. Two equals, you taste the qual. You understand? Whatever. Watching you put eight of those in there sickens me.
Yeah, well, I was watching Monday Night Football, and what was amazing was that burger commercial with your voice coming out of a burger sign.
That was on Monday Night Football?
Yeah, it's great.
Wow, what time was that? I was watching Monday Night
Whatever.
Football. Thank you.
What time was that?
It was probably
7 o'clock.
End of the game, the beginning of the game?
7:30-ish.
And it was towards the end of the first half, I believe, the first time I saw.
Which one was it?
Quarter, yeah.
What commercial was it?
Some black gals in an elevator.
Oh, yeah.
It was good.
Those are my main women.
Oh, excuse me.
Yeah. Brady?
Yeah.
You're 21?
Yeah.
You haven't masturbated in 2 years?
Yeah.
Why not?
Well, I've got this kind of predicament. Well, I'm about to be serving a full-time mission for my church in probably about 3 months.
Mm-hmm.
And I've been having frequent interviews with my bishop in order to prepare myself.
Hold on. Is that a euphemism for beating off?
And what's that now?
Having frequent interviews with your bishop? That sounds like something like... really just sounds like something you'd say. Like, what's going on with your why you been in the bathroom so long, Chet? I'm interviewing my bishop, okay? Give me a break.
That's a new...
It does sound good, though, right?
Yes.
All right. So by... when you're saying interviewing with your bishop, you mean you're actually physically speaking to someone in the church.
Right.
Not beating off.
Not slapping the bishop.
Exactly.
Interesting. Interesting.
Yeah.
And now, what is your faith?
I'm LDS.
That's the Latter-day Saints.
Right.
Which I, the whole Mormon and the LDS thing, figured that out until about a year ago.
They're the same?
Yeah, didn't exist where I was from. You're Mormons.
Right.
We didn't have
LDS.
The LDS. And why do you guys go by LDS? Does Mormon have a stigma to it? That
no. Well, see, Latter-day Saints. It's actually the full name of our church is the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints.
Right. Right. Yeah. I'm just saying that's a Mormon, right? You're Mormon, right?
Right.
All right, go with Mormon. Okay. Live it up a little. Be proud.
It's a euphemism.
Yeah, but LDS sounds like a disease.
LSD.
It just sounds like Lou Gehrig. Sounds like a cross between what's Lou Gehrig's?
All right.
What's Lou Gehrig's, Bruce?
Amyotrophic lateral sclerosis.
Yeah, but
ALS.
What is it?
ALS.
ALS. Oh, you're just an idiot with a long wind. Yeah, it sounds like a different, it sounds like it, a cross between ALS and LSD. But anyway.
Spastic.
Well, right, okay, well, to the problem.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
To the problem.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Slapping anyway, the bishop.
Right.
The problem is I go to a local community college here.
Ooh.
In Dallas, and there's, like, hot chicks everywhere. I mean, like, every single class period. I'm in there, and there's just, I'm, like, surrounded by hot chicks.
Yeah.
All day, every day. And, you know, I'm 21, you know, I'm at, like, my peak here. And, like, you know, I should be, in my opinion, you know, at least able to, you know, spank off, you know, once a week, at least.
I don't know if I buy Brady's story anymore.
You don't know any Mormons, then.
Is he just sort of waxing on about waxing off?
You know what I mean? He's seeing the bishop every week.
But do you know what I'm saying? What is he saying? He hasn't masturbated in 2 years. He's 21. He should be able to. He should want to. So why don't you?
Well, this mission is like, it's something that I really want to do.
Is it a 2 year?
I think that it'll like give me.
What mission? Are you on a mission now?
No.
Where's your mission going to be?
I'm not sure yet. I just put in my application.
Well, why is that stopping you? Why don't you just beat off?
He has to be pure for the mission.
Well, exactly. If I spank off or whatever, then, you know, I can't go on my mission for, you know, like another year.
Is that written down somewhere, or is that just like hearsay?
Yeah, I mean, it's like actual, like, you know.
Masturbation.
But what's the text say? What does it say?
Well, I mean, it's not part of like scripture, but
right.
It's like, you know, it's something that, you know, the guy, it's just a requirement, you know, because
you have to be in, I guess,
some sort of morally clean mind frame or something.
What about like popping a zit? Would you be able to take that out of your body?
That's a little extreme there, fellas. No.
Okay, Brady. What about, you know, what nocturnal emissions are? When you have an orgasm in your sleep?
Right.
Okay, do you have those?
Yeah.
I'm sure you do. Do you have to report those to the bishop?
Yeah.
God, no, come on. Seriously?
Yeah.
No way.
Okay, listen.
Wait.
The reason I asked them about it is because, like, I've actually woken up a couple of times during those and actually kind of finished the job myself. And I was...
Oh, well, that you got to report.
Exactly.
Unacceptable.
Okay.
Listen.
Brady's... He's got a pretty good sense of humor for a guy who hasn't beat off in 2 years. Which reminds me,
in two minutes.
I'm going to count for traffic, but I got about 2 hours and 10 minutes. Uh-huh. But you look, this, what is it, Yom Kippur today?
That's a different religion, though.
I know.
It's a holy day.
They're all just a bunch of nonsense. All the Jews are fetching because they're not eating. This guy can't beat off. Let's just do what you want to do and don't hurt anybody.
I'm closer to the cloth than you are. Maybe I can give him some advice.
I know. I'm tired. I'm done with him.
All right.
He's talking to his bishop about beating off. Fine. I don't even know what his question was. He hasn't beat off in 2 years. If you want to do it, do it. You'll still go to heaven.
Right.
Believe me. And is that what the Mormons have? They have heaven?
Oh, they have multiple levels.
Multiple levels of heaven. It's very involved.
You're leaving Brady in a very pressured state.
He's fine. Okay. Just beat off. And listen to me, all you screwballs who want to follow your ridiculous religious ceremonies. Don't complain. Your religion dictates that you got to use two sets of dishes, or you got to grow your beard out like your Charles Manson, or you can't beat off for 2 years. Then go ahead, have fun with it. Don't call me and whine about it. You ridiculous nonsense religions calling me and, I'm not supposed to have sex. I'm not supposed to masturbate. I can't mix dairy and bovine. I can't just go have fun. We're going to start an island for all you idiots.
Well,
you guys can all just sit around with your ridiculous rituals and go back and forth. You Jews can talk about what's going on Saturday and about fasting. You crazy Mormons can do your own thing. Everyone, you guys just sit around and discuss all your bizarre behaviors and complain to each other about it. You don't want to do it? Don't do it. But don't call me and complain about it.
Got
idiots.
That, Brady?
Yeah, look, you wanted to be Mormon. Have fun not beating off. Idiots. There's people, and we treat these people like they're sane. Oh, you haven't beat off in 2 years. Oh, yes, I see. The chaos grows from the thing and the beard, and you can't touch your face with metal. And
you know,
shut up, you idiots.
Brady.
This is retarded. Why doesn't society just come down on these people and tell them to just shut up, go move to some island somewhere?
I think you're the part of society coming down on them, but I think...
Thank you.
For Brady, it's a private part of your life. I think you need not to discuss
That's
this with your
right.
bishop,
That's
and
right.
you're having normal sexual impulses. And you're a little
right.
overboard on the...
You talk to the bishop about finishing yourself off in the middle of the night when you had a dream about
right.
When your sister's friend's on a pirate ship. That's a great, healthy conversation to have at 21.
Tell him how pure you are by not being involved with any women. I don't think you have
right.
to go into your bathroom activities.
That's right.
Then just shut up.
Thank you.
Thank you, Drew.
Louis?
Yeah.
Or Louise? What do you go with, Louis?
Louis,
you're 15.
Yeah.
What's up?
Yeah, I want to know, I was watching the other day, and you guys have, like, you know, your mask peel out and on the Man Show?
Yeah.
And Man Pawn and Crack Smacker.
Right.
Know,
Crack Spackle.
Spackle, my bad.
Yeah, okay, mask peel out is a detergent specifically designed to remove protein from my garments. It's a long story, but we've had some good products on the Man Show.
Yes.
It's commercial parodies.
Yeah, this is...
What do we do with what?
Like, who has to keep it?
You know, I don't know. The art department, we describe to them what we want them to make. They make it. Then we tell them it sucks, and they make it five more times. Then we do a commercial with commercial parody with the product that they made that we like most of the time. And then it goes back to the art department. And eventually, they take it home, or it gets destroyed or lost. They never see, and stuff gets wet, stuff gets destroyed.
You know the prop that I want? It's a giant Frank Sinatra picture.
Yeah.
Where'd that go?
That may have went.
That went to Jimmy's.
That may have went to Jimmy's.
It did.
But, we have created a lot of cool stuff at the Man Show, posters for movies and products and things like that, and they all get ruined and or thrown out or recycled.
Your house or Jimmy's house.
Yeah, it's amazing what happens with that stuff. Katie? No, I don't get much of it. Katie, you're 28. What's up?
My boyfriend works out, healthy guy, and works out pretty intensely, and has been looking into Andro. I know McGuire takes it. I've actually done some internet research, and I just wanted to know, no one's mentioned anything about future fertility. We've been dating for a while, and we've been talking about getting married, and I know it's the testosterone, and I just wanted to get your input if you know anything about, I assume testosterone, obviously that's a big part of fertility, and they also talk about estrogen and
All right. Well, let's talk to Bruce about it. Is it androstenedione
or
something?
I think he was taking DHEA, right?
Honestly, I'm not sure.
Because
who's he?
I just know it's Andro.
She's talking about McGuire, right?
Well, I think McGuire was taking that.
The DHEA. Okay. And DHEA is still over the counter.
What is DHEA?
Dehydroepiandrosterone.
But he was taking that Andro, too.
Well, is Andro a trade? I don't. I'm not familiar with that.
Maybe that's a trade
the
name.
The stacking, the full-on steroid replacement. You know, the stacking, the shots, and
right.
the whole thing that the weightlifters do. That I think they test for in Major League Baseball. It's different than the DHEA. The DHEA is
over
the counter.
Well, hold on a second. You don't know what androstenedione is, or
yeah,
whatever
that's the
it's
DHEA.
Called? Okay. Well, stop.
Where's Dr. True?
Stop it. Yeah, she says...
No, you said Andro. I thought she was describing a trade name for something else.
She says McGuire's was taking Andro. You then say, yeah, I know he's taking DHEA. Then I say, is that androstenedione? And you say, I don't know, that's a brand name.
No.
And I say, he was taking Andro? And you go, no, he's taking DHEA. You just keep saying DHEA. That's Andro, yes?
Androstenedione.
It is, yes.
Yeah.
Say yes.
Yes.
Okay, now let's continue, because you understand it's confusing when
okay.
you pick another name for something that this guy was taking, and I keep saying, wasn't it this,
right.
and you just keep saying your initials back to me.
Okay.
You won't agree. Do you understand
yes,
what I'm saying now?
I will avoid this behavior in the future.
Okay, so he's taking androstenedione, which is also DHEA.
Right.
All right,
so
here
Katie,
we go.
Bottom line is sperm, which you need for fertility, you're not going to have a direct, you'll have an effect on sperm count, but in the long run, once the androgens are stopped, that shouldn't be a factor. What's of more concern are cardiac and liver effects and other organs being affected long term, and that's not really attached to DHEA, but if he's doing the stacking, if he's using the other androgens, the more potent androgens, as a bodybuilder.
Is a steroid an androgen?
Androgens are types of steroids.
All right. Yeah. Well, is he taking the more potent stuff?
No, he's... I don't know if you want to believe me or not, but he truly isn't, never done steroids and doesn't want to do anything, the potential that the, you know, like the injections and all that stuff. But the more research he's been doing in terms of the andro, it seems to have not as ill effect as the stacking and the major injections in it.
Right. But also the... there's really not much known as to what the benefits are. The harm doesn't seem to be there as with the other methods that are used by weightlifters and bodybuilders with the more potent steroids. But to take something that really doesn't have any real endpoint, really not sure what the benefit is.
Yeah.
Because not everybody has the body that McGuire does, and you don't know what he's, what other nutritional supplements he's using. So a lot of people started doing it when they heard McGuire was doing it. So.
Yeah, and listen, McGuire looks like McGuire because he's McGuire. So is every other guy in the NBA, and so is every other guy in the NFL.
Yeah.
I mean, listen, I knew guys, they just, people look different. People are a little bigger, a little more muscular.
Yeah, but do you notice the careers are shortened by using the steroids? It even seems like the DHEA, they're taking larger doses, and there's always a payback.
Are you driving the boat?
What? Hey, Priscilla?
Hi.
Yeah, what about the boat?
Oh, what?
What'd you say about the boat, Priscilla?
Boat? Oh, I don't know. I was talking to my sister.
Did you Did you say something about a boat?
No. My question is.
What did you say to your sister?
Oh, she was just asking me this question. I didn't know I was on the phone yet.
What'd you say to her though?
Oh, she was talking about how she went on a boat ride with her friend.
Right. And you said, were you driving the boat?
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. Now you got to stay on hold for another 20 minutes. Do you see what my job is?
Yeah, yeah.
How much boat talk did I have to get into her?
I don't know, but she's got the big energetic call there, so.
All right. I'm going to put
high
her on
energy,
hold.
High energy, right.
But did you hear that exchange?
Yeah. She's
what
got
did
my,
you say about a boat?
My disorder. I don't know.
What did you say about a boat? Nothing. What did you say about a boat? Nothing. What did you say about a boat? Nothing. What did you say? I was talking to my sister. What did you say to your sister? Nothing. What did you say to I just asked her about a boat. She
did you?
Look, boat.
But she's 14. That's normal.
I don't
when you're
care.
14. That's the way your brain works.
No way.
Yes.
No way. No.
I would,
oh, okay.
Okay. When you were 14, that's the way. You
no
think.
Way.
Okay.
No way.
Do you want to talk about? There's another Mormon that was going to explain
no.
the.
Catherine.
Okay. Yes.
Priscilla, don't worry. I'll get back to you in a little while. Catherine, you're 22. What's up?
Okay. I had this boyfriend, and things weren't working out well, and I started having sex with my coworker,
mm-hmm.
and now I have some foreign smell, and I'm not sure what it's from, and I'm not sure if I should be concerned that I caught something, although I've asked him, and he says that he's fine,
mm-hmm.
and now I'm just concerned.
Okay, and hold on a second. What do you do for a living?
I'm a loan officer.
I see.
Hmm.
And this is a guy you work with. You're currently with your boyfriend, though. You've not broken
up.
You did break up.
Yes.
You broke up. And are you seeing this new guy now?
No, it's casual sex.
It's casual sex.
Unprotected?
Yes.
Yes. Mm. And you've had sex with him how many times?
Four times.
Four times. And have an orgasm?
I have complications with orgasm.
Nice.
Okay, so are we talking about a fishy smell, a foul odor, or a...
I have no idea. It's completely foreign, and I don't know what it is. It's not, like, gross fishy. It's just...
Right.
I don't know. And then it's, like...
Mm-hmm.
It's really disgusting.
Mm-hmm. Armenian really, guy?
No, it's not.
Just playing a hunch. Just playing a hunch. And let me ask this. I mean, maybe she's just got herself, little bacteria down there.
No.
There's a little yeast.
That's what an STD is.
Little yeast?
Well, yeast is less...
I see, and the thing that's freaking me out is I'm, like, hygiene sensitive, so I'm really conscious about hygiene. And,
right.
What
happened to the hygiene...
is that I'm not using protective sex, but now I'm having, like a thick discharge. It sucks, and I'm freaking out.
All right. Okay, so you stepped up to the STD buffet, and you...
Really?
Partook. Sure.
Got the discharge and the smell.
Right. So.
Was that chlamydia?
Well, the smell's usually like trichomonas.
And the discharge? What are the STDs that do discharge and smell? Is there a handful of them for women?
Discharge is gonorrhea, chlamydia. Those are the classic is gonorrhea. Then chlamydia can have a discharge. Chlamydia also is.
And what did you say it was at the beginning?
Oh, trichomonas is like.
Right. And you said that because I said.
Fishy smell.
The guy said discharge and gonorrhea.
And then yeast is not really an STD, but with.
Right, but we don't know she has an STD.
Yeah, she needs a pelvic exam and a culture, and she'll be treated no matter what. I mean, with what she's describing, she has an STD. And you don't wait for the results of a culture. You just
because
treat.
If this is yeast, you wouldn't have the discharge.
Nah, different, right?
But what else other than the smell? The smell and the discharge—that's yeast. I mean, that's a STD.
Yeah, if you have if you've had intercourse, it's unprotected, and now you're having a discharge.
All
right.
That's...
Right, but it happened like right away.
Yeah, well, that's the way it goes.
Right away, meaning
the day after. Like,
the day after.
You have like a day to. I mean,
that can
you didn't
happen.
Have any time to actually
ferment.
You know, and exactly.
All right.
And so it happened like the very next day.
Yeah, all well, right. That part of your body is like a culture medium. I mean, it's couldn't find a better place to grow bacteria.
Yeah, it's a regular greenhouse. It's really, it's like taking a baseball mitt and soaking it in stream water, and then putting it under a glass lid and putting it out in the sun and near an Aztec pyramid somewhere, in 90-degree weather.
Yeah,
humidity at 70%.
Taking a pair of your old underwear and socks together in a
that's right
in an oven at a low temperature with some
no, it needs moisture.
Oh, okay.
You know what I'm saying?
I was
all
assuming
right.
There was some moisture there, but
let's so. Well, that's a good point. That's a good point.
So she needs to go to the emergency room tonight.
That tonight?
Yeah.
Why tonight?
Well, let me tell her why.
Just, I don't got time
take 2 seconds.
For you to tell her why. All right.
Catherine, go to the emergency room tonight. Here's why. Because if you have chlamydia in there, which is not unlikely, you get scarring and it happens quickly. And if it's gonorrhea, it can spread. There are a lot of bad things that can happen. And we goof around a lot on the show. You need to get that treated. And if you go to an emergency room, they'll do a pelvic, they'll do the cultures, but they'll give you the antibiotics immediately. Okay?
But wouldn't that cost me like an arm and a leg? I'm uninsured.
Well, yeah, well, I'll tell you, if you're infertile, it'll cost you a bigger arm. It'll cost 2 arms and 2 legs to get pregnant, so...
It's going to cost her vagina right now. All right, let's take a little break. And nice, Bruce. You're fired up. Well, let me tell you, if you're infertile, it's going to cost you 2 arms and I don't know.
2 breaths. I will avoid this behavior in the future.
Thank you.
Oh, thank you, Anderson.
All right, let's take ourselves a little break. Dr. Drew, not in tonight. We will we'll hear the Dr. Drew boogie or shuffle or whatever Anderson wants to play. He pouts when I ask to hear one of them, and I can't remember which one it is. So whichever one you want to play, Anderson,
he wants to play the one
play
he did
later on tonight.
His
all right?
creation.
All right. And we'll be right back after this.
1-800-LOVE-191. We'll be right back. LoveLine is brought to you by Trojan, America's number one condom, the most trusted for over 80 years.
Hey everybody, it's LoveLine. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Bruce filling in for Dr. Drew one more night, then Dr. Drew back. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Dr. Bruce got a handful of gel in his hair. He's got a coffee that has 28 sweet and lows in it, and he's ready to rock. That's right. Emergency medicine, this man knows. Hey, if you got a car accident, you'd want Dr. Bruce with you.
Yeah, like
not Dr. Drew. Oh, yes. Dr.
Remember the
Bruce.
bloody night when I came in covered with...
Yeah, came
that
in.
Was really exciting.
Saw somebody...
Here's cigarettes and bowels. Yeah. That's sort of an unusual...
Let me just say something.
Oh, excuse me.
So you can't just say, remember the bloody night I came in?
Yeah. Bad radio.
Yeah, it's bad because people know, what do you mean, what bloody night you came in? What happened? You fight with your wife? What happened? Someone give birth? Bruce was driving in, bad accident on the freeway. He lent a hand and physically got blood on him.
Yeah.
That was the bloody night,
the bloody night.
He came in. Mm-hmm. You understand?
Thank you.
You're like Drew. You used the mic as an intercom to speak to me.
Drew's trained me on this.
Drew uses the mic. Drew treats this mic like it's his own personal walkie-talkie and just has conversations with me. He likes to hold stuff up. Hey, look at this. What's that? Likes to wave at producer Ann when she doesn't see him and say stuff to her that no one knows about.
And he sits there sometimes and holds his head like this during the entire show.
Yeah. Well, that's so he can more easily punch the microphone. Wendy?
Yes, hello.
Hey, you're 23.
I am.
What's up?
When I smoke a cigarette, I need to move my bowels. Am I the only person in the world this happens to?
No, that's common.
Is this normal?
Yeah, cigarettes, coffee, stimulants.
Right.
They get you going.
Okay, so I don't need to seek help.
No, but there's a teaching point here. Okay, yes.
What?
Go ahead.
Well, just nicotine and the contents of cigarette smoke enter your bloodstream immediately and travel to all parts of your body. And people that smoke have higher risk of cancer in all those parts of the body. So,
uh-oh.
Yeah, no, really. So that's sort of an example of how quickly the smoke going to your lungs gets into your bloodstream and affects all your organs. And the nicotine is actually, it can both stimulate and depress at nerve junctions. And it does both in the brain. And it's a potent antidepressant. But in your bowels, and there are thoughts that some diseases of the bowels actually are caused by cigarettes. And,
oh.
Well, the more time goes on, the more disease states there are that are associated with cigarette smoking. So,
yeah. Okay. And you know, secondhand smoke, everybody, first-rate killer. First-rate killer, secondhand smoke.
Well, that's a little overdone, isn't
first-rate
it?
First-rate killer, yeah. Bruce. You're a doctor.
I get tired of hearing about...
You've treated thousands and thousands of people over the years for secondhand smoke. Have you not? I mean, this is a first-rate killer. I've seen the campaigns. I've seen the billboards. 53,000 people died last year nationally of secondhand smoke. And we all know a family, a loved one, a sports superstar, a teacher.
I agree with you.
We all know someone who's died of secondhand smoke, do we not?
Yeah, we do.
It's touched all our lives. I mean, you go to any graveyard anywhere in the country, about every third headstone, secondhand smoke.
Yeah.
Yeah, 53,000 people nationally, and that's about as many as Vietnam.
Yeah.
It's tragic, isn't it? It's a war we're fighting at home.
Seems to be overdone a bit.
The thousands.
I don't know where they get those statistics from, but
Here's the whole thing about the anti-cigarette folks. I gotta have had an asshole of these people. A, I don't know what they're talking about with the secondhand smoke, and I know they don't know what they're talking about either. They just don't. They love to talk about how this is a first-rate killer, and that sort of thing. Secondhand smoke, first-rate killer. But you tell me, Bruce, as a doctor, where does secondhand smoke rank on the list of killers in this nation?
Well, the way they figure this out.
Oh, I know the way they figure it out.
You
they
do.
Just spin it however goddamn way they decide to spin it so it can help them make their point.
No, if you take a control group of spouses or someone that's in some physical proximity to a smoker, and you have a group where they're non-smokers and smokers and the people, whether it's wives or husbands, and you compare the two groups and you compare disease levels, then people that are married to smokers that don't smoke do have higher levels.
Yeah, but they don't do it that way because they wouldn't come up with 50-something thousand people every year.
Okay, but remember the smoking and non-smoking sections on a plane? I mean, you got this metal tube up in the sky and there's not a whole lot of exchange of air with the external atmosphere, I don't think.
Right.
And you'd be sitting in the no-smoking area and somebody in front smoking. So you really, in certain circumstances where there's poor ventilation, you are inhaling a lot of the same poisons.
I know. You're doing it twice a year when you go to Singapore, and it's no big deal. What if you live in New York or L.A.? Isn't there the airborne particles and stuff like that? I mean, isn't that just as bad? I mean, why does living in New York, there's buses driving up and down the street all day long? I mean, how come people in New York don't die 20 years earlier or before people in Iowa?
Well, there's more respiratory disease if you live in a city.
Yeah.
Whether it's L.A. or New York.
Are they dying?
The carcinogens in cigarette smoke are pretty astounding. In the chemicals, it's pretty astounding to look at.
What about the carcinogens in diesel?
Well, diesel is not nearly as bad. I mean, cigarette smoke, if you're in the same room with somebody smoking, you probably have to walk through London for 24 hours to get the same effect as one cigarette.
Well, if you live in that city, though, full time.
Yeah, but you're looking at pretty basic hydrocarbons when you're talking about diesel exhaust.
Okay, so you'd rather take in car exhaust than secondhand smoke.
Well, I'm not going to suck on the tailpipe, you know, for
an hour or two. And what about the fact that this costs us so much from a healthcare standpoint?
Well, I think most of that's tax
don't these people just die in their 60s? What about my grandparents who've never stopped taxing the system well into their 80s and 90s?
Well, the idea is people that smoke and people that live with people that smoke that don't smoke have much more frequent, they miss work more frequently, they have lots of other illnesses along the way that cost the taxpayer money, that cost the system money. So.
I see, right, like Churchill. Guy couldn't get anything done until he was 90. Brittany?
Yeah.
You're 16?
Yeah.
Hold on. Speak to
Priscilla.
Priscilla. Priscilla?
Hi.
All right, you're 14 now. What's up, baby?
Yeah, okay, well, I have these two friends, and one's a guy and one's a girl, and they're dating. And they're both, like, my best friends in the whole wide world. But I like the guy, like, a really lot, and they just, like, really like each other, and I don't really know what to do because I really like him, and I don't know if I'll ever get over it.
You probably will in about 30 years, 30, 35 years. Yeah, you really have a crush on this guy, right?
Yeah.
And he's really into your friend.
Yeah.
Yeah.
How long do the relationships that your friends have last? Because when you're 14, the nice thing about being 14 is usually if you like somebody, if you wait a couple of weeks, the relationship's over. And
yeah, especially if you put a curse on it.
Kind of. I mean, they've been going out for a while, probably 6 months.
6 months.
That's a long time.
That's a pretty long run for 14.
But now they're far apart, and so I don't know if they're going to break up or what.
Why? Where's he?
Well, he's in Seattle, and she's in Olympia, so.
No, it's never going to work. And they're not just visiting for the summer or anything. They've moved to different parts.
Well, no, actually, they both lived in Seattle, but we all did. But then she moved, so.
All right, she moved. Yeah. All right, well, this is it. That's it.
It's all
How far is Olympia and Seattle apart?
I don't know.
An hour?
Is it an hour?
It's like a couple hours, right?
It's probably 2 hours or...
Listen, the nice thing about being 14, Priscilla, is that you don't have to make any big-time commitments. You can just date whoever you want to date. I just go out and have a good time and just don't have sex with anybody. Don't get pregnant.
I know. I know. I don't even think about that. But I just like him so much, and I don't know what I should do.
Well, you can be friends. Call him up. You can talk to him.
Yeah, but, you know, what if he pledged his love for you tomorrow? Don't you think you'd get sick of him in about 2 weeks?
No.
Yeah, that's what you say.
Well, because I've known him for so long, and we used to like each other, like, before my friend came along.
Oh, you're going to blame her, but why weren't you going out with him?
I don't know.
Well, maybe he didn't like you.
No, he did. Well, he liked me before I liked him.
He liked you, you liked him, and now what?
And then my friend came along, and then it all went downhill.
Yeah, you're blaming your friend, but... Why didn't he just go for you, or why didn't you do something about it?
I don't know.
All right,
Priscilla,
well, don't beat up your friend.
Get a picture of Adam Carolla. Put it up on a wall in your room, and when you get depressed about this guy, you can look at Adam's picture. And
yeah.
Okay.
That's right. It's just like you used to do with Bobby Sherman when you were 14, Bruce.
Me?
Yeah.
How gay.
Easy come, easy go. All right, let's talk to Brittany. Brittany?
Yeah.
You're 16?
Yeah.
Yeah. What is up?
Nothing. Well, I have a question, actually. I broke up with my boyfriend about 4 months ago, and I've been seeing this guy that I've known, like, my whole life since we were 7. And we just recently started having sex, but he's, like, really rough, like, biting and hair pulling. And I like it, but is there something wrong with me? Because my friends tell me that that's, like, rape, you know, like...
Yeah, well, how...
Related to rape.
Well, have you had any trauma in the past?
No, not really.
No? Nobody slapped you around or raped you or anything?
No.
Okay. Well, then go ahead.
Nah. What was your family like growing up? Your relationship with your dad? Where's your dad now?
My parents are still married, and we're, like, a really close family, so...
Nobody's an alcoholic? Nobody swats you?
No.
Okay.
Well, here's the thing, Brittany. You're 16?
Yeah.
And how old's the guy?
He's, 18.
Yeah, okay. And for you to be having that kind of sexual, intimacy with somebody where that kind of treatment's involved... Not really healthy at this point. It's not healthy for you. You're going to get used to it. And that's not exactly where you should be. And
this guy's
sounds bad, but if you're having sex, then what's wrong with the hair pulling?
Because that she's learning patterns that she's going to get used to this as being normal. And
well,
definitely
maybe that
not,
is.
Well,
I mean, maybe it's what she enjoys.
Yeah, but at age 16.
No, I know. Listen, I wouldn't be a big fan of it either if I was like her dad, but I'm just saying she's 16. She's having regular sex. She likes this type of sex. She probably will her whole life. I mean, she's getting a little head start.
How many partners have you had?
Four.
Yeah. Okay. And this guy, how long have you been with him?
Well, we aren't technically together.
No. No.
So you're just hooking up with the guy, and when you have sex, he gets rough.
Yeah.
Well, she likes him to get rough, though, right?
Right. But my friends are all telling me that it's like rape and that it's wrong for me to like it.
And this guy does a little neck bite and a little hair pull.
Yeah.
And it's not excessive? I mean, you ever have marks on you, or are you sore afterwards?
Yeah, I have marks.
You do? On your neck?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, okay.
Maybe it's getting a little excessive now.
You know, it's not an ideal world, but ideally, sex is a part of intimacy, it's a part of love, and you're hooking up with a guy, and he's getting rough with you.
Oh,
not you're setting up a pattern that's not good. And when you meet a guy that's normal, you might find that boring, and that could develop into a problem. So
okay.
Your friends, you know, I don't know if it's got anything to do with rape, but this would suggest, as Adam was asking, have you had any abuse in the past, that there's some problem with your boundaries. Yeah. And I wouldn't pursue that relationship. I wouldn't continue to see the guy.
Well, hold on a second.
No.
Well, we were talking about this last night off the air. I think that most women like some form of dominance in the sack.
But she's 16.
That's true. And that's a little bit young.
And he's 18.
And also, it's a little bit young to be having these casual relationships where you're not really boyfriend and girlfriend. He's just coming over and pulling your hair and biting your neck.
And she's almost got the little girl voice. Doesn't she? Almost.
Yeah, but almost doesn't really count. All right, so Brittany, I'm with Bruce on this one. I think you got to reel it in a little bit. Slow it
There's
down.
Something else going on. With
yes, Brittany. And have a relationship if you want a relationship. But don't get into any of this sort of service agreement with these 18-year-olds. It's not a good place to
You're
start
being
life.
Used.
That's right.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's take a little break. When we come back, we'll speak to Julia, 17. Says it's common for Mormons to talk to their bishops about everything. No, I don't want to talk to her. Let's talk to Casey. Wants to practice an orgasm. How can she practice an orgasm? It's too intense.
Or else I also want to know, why haven't you been on MTV Cribs?
Oh, that's a question, too. Hold on. Casey?
Yeah?
You're 17?
Mm-hmm.
Have you ever had an orgasm?
No.
Okay. Well, hold on a second.
Okay.
All right. It's ridiculous that I talk to 16 and 17-year-olds about their sexual life, is it not?
As long as you're not going to help her have the first orgasm.
Well, maybe
not.
That's
Ann's job.
All right, after this.
Love Life. We'll be right back. Call them at 1-800-LOVE-191.
Buddy, it's Loveline. I'm Adam. That's Dr. Bruce. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Dr. Bruce filling in for Dr. Drew, who is, I don't know where. Do you know where he is?
No, but isn't it Good Morning America Monday?
Yeah.
New York, I would say.
Somebody dropped a nickel somewhere. And Drew, here's what happens. Drew hears the nickel hit the ground in New York, and he hears it rolling toward the gutter. He springs up in the middle of the night. He's covered with sweat, and he immediately jumps on a plane and heads for New York.
Just a nickel?
Yeah.
Nah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, the symbolic nickel.
Oh, I see. Okay.
The symbolic nickel, which is now a dime at least. So he's doing Good Morning America? Is that what he's doing, Ann? No.
No. Okay.
Thank you, Bruce. Thank you very much. Okay. He's in Texas. Chasing money in Texas? I see.
Yeah.
All right.
Mm-hmm. Casey?
Mm-hmm.
Painful erection that will not go away.
That's right. You're 17.
Yeah.
And have you had an orgasm or not?
No.
Mm-hmm. And you'd like to get one?
Well, yeah. It's like every time like I'll have sex, like it'll... Or no, not really sex, but like more when a guy will go down on me.
Mm-hmm.
Like I'll be so close and it'll be like so intense that I'll make them stop.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, okay, the best way I could describe it is like when you're being tickled, but you're laughing, but it hurts. Like,
right.
You don't want to be tickled.
Yeah. Becomes overwhelming.
Yeah, like.
Yeah, this happens to certain women.
Perfectly normal.
Like, right.
How long have you been having sex?
Since the end of my freshman year.
And so, how many partners?
A few, like 7, I think.
And mm-hmm. Is sexual activity usually after you've been in a relationship for a while, or is it more just hooking up with somebody?
Well, it used to be that way, and now I've changed. I'm better now, so, like, I'm in a relationship now.
Mm-hmm.
But, mm-hmm. So I don't know. And also, like, I have an IUD, and so it hurts to have sex now. And when I didn't have the IUD, it didn't.
You're 17 and have an IUD.
Yeah, I had a baby last year at 16.
Nice.
And I did the good thing and did adoption.
Good times.
Like, open adoption.
Mm-hmm.
And then I just got put on the IUD because the birth control's too, like, I don't know. If you miss one, then you're messed up for the rest of the month. So I didn't want to deal with that.
Yeah. See what a pain in the ass these women are.
Well, you've got some adult sexual issues going on, and it's, you know.
Well, she's having trouble with her orgasms.
Yeah, but she's 17. How old's your boyfriend?
41.
Turned 20 last week.
Yeah, so.
That's a little weird.
Yeah. So.
I'm almost 18.
Yeah.
You're almost 18, but you're not. And are you living at home with your mom and dad? What's your family like?
Yeah, I live at home with my mother and my stepdad.
How does the open adoption work?
It pretty much, like, I can see her whenever I want, and they can't refuse to let me see her, and they're really nice people. I got to pick them. I got to interview different people.
Yeah, I know, because when you're 17, you're such a goddamn expert at this kind of stuff, right? to interview people. I like this guy's shirt. He's in. What band is that, dude?
Like, I got to stay with them while I was pregnant, and they were really nice, and I picked them, you know.
Well, that's great. It sounds like a very responsible thing to do.
It does. That is good. That is good. I don't know. I don't agree with the part where you get to pick the person.
Well, she has input. Like, anybody,
right.
So.
I'll let the experts do that. But God bless you for giving the kid up, and now using birth control. And the orgasm part in life, pardon the pun, will come. You're 17. You've had a child. You got an IUD.
And she's probably had some pretty negative experiences sexually and a lot of just hooking up with somebody. And that's having an orgasm is not just having an orgasm. It has to do with the relationship and
mm-hmm.
who she's with. And
all right. So the part where it's difficult, she gets very close to it but can't quite let go.
Yeah, there's not a therapy for that. She needs to
get comfortable with herself, with her partner.
And just give it some time, like you said.
That's right.
Right.
Okay. Let's talk to...
That was the Mormon...
that's right.
Rebuttal.
Kylie?
Kyle.
Kyle, oh. Sorry.
Yeah.
And you're 14?
Yeah.
And you want to know what the question... What is your question?
I sleepwalk, and I wanted to know why and how I can stop.
You thought this was the Mormon question, but
was.
That
it
one fell
away.
Off.
Okay,
yeah.
No problem. But sleepwalking's...
Yeah, good enough. You don't hear about this sleepwalking so much anymore. What about it, Bruce? Supposed to be dangerous.
No. Sleepwalking, it's actually pretty much normal. And it happens up until early teen years pretty commonly in some kids. I would assume this is probably started when you were much younger.
Yeah, 7.
Okay.
Yeah.
Have you been to the family practitioner? Have you gone through the usual? Usually parents bring them to the family practitioner. They take a psychosocial history, any abuse, any trauma, any major issues. Anything going on when you were younger? Abuse?
Nope. Nothing like that.
All right.
It's sort of a benign sleep disorder.
All right. It's not dangerous.
Not dangerous. Well, some kids have, you know, walked out of the house and...
Do you walk out of the house? You take your dad's pickup truck down to the liquor store for some smokes? What do?
The thing is, I have a bunk bed, and I sleep on the top bunk, and sometimes I'll wake up on the couch,
Yeah, and you don't remember how you got down there?
I have no idea.
Yeah, I spent half my time on the road that way in my car. I don't care. Let's face it. I mean, you don't remember a goddamn thing when you're sleep-deprived. That's the first thing that goes.
Absolutely. And you're very sleep-deprived.
I have been sleep-deprived lately, but the last, like, for instance, I come back to this studio to do some radio tour thing I got to do, like, on Thursday or Friday. I got to be back here at, like, 4 a.m.
Oh.
I'll go home. Oh, if I do Stern, I got to come back here at 3 a.m. Go home, go to bed at, like, 1:30, get up at, like, 2:15 or 2:30. I don't know what the hell time I'm going to get up, but whenever I do this thing, like, on Thursday or Friday, I go to bed at my usual 2 o'clock and get up at, like, 3:15. I'll drive over back to Loveline, back to the studio. You think I'm going to remember that drive?
No.
No, I don't remember that drive. I won't remember the drive home, and I won't remember one thing I said on this five-hour radio tour thing I'm doing.
Well, you're a big star now. Why don't you get the limo? You sleep.
I use that time to wake up while I'm driving. But the point is much worse shape than you are when you're over 0.10. Or, I'm sorry, 0.08. You're much worse shape, sleep-deprived.
Right.
And I would like to do a test where someone who was completely sleep-deprived tried to do some coordination task and then compare them to someone who had three beers.
Oh, yeah.
Who had a full night's sleep the night before.
Oh, it's a fact that many accidents are caused probably just as commonly as drinking from people that are falling asleep at the wheel.
So let's get rid of this DUI stuff. That's my message.
That's your message.
That's Bruce's message. That's the way I interpret your message.
I'd rather talk about
you for that message.
Married a first
Thank you for the get rid of the DUI message. We will take ourselves a little break. We'll be right back.
Married a first cousin, and it's not in the Midwest.
All right, guys, here's the deal. Looking to hook up? Call the Dateline. Sick of wasting time with the wrong person?
Call the Dateline.
One call is all you need to make.
Call the Dateline.
1-877-889-DATE.
You know what I'm saying out there?
Adam and Dr. Drew will be right back on Loveline.
Loveline, I'm Adam. That's Dr. Bruce. Dr. Bruce filling in for Dr. Drew. Dr. Drew back tomorrow night. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Wednesday night, 311 is going to be in here. And Jim Brewer, the comedian, is going to be in on Thursday. I don't think I've ever met Jim Brewer. Has Jim Brewer done this show, producer Ann? I'm a little sleep-deprived, so I'm trying to get the Jim Brewer sheep line. Now, did you do a movie where he was involved with sheep?
He's Goat Boy.
Oh,
Goat Boy.
Is that a goat? Or see, I don't think like sheep. Yeah, it's sheep.
Is there really a difference between the sound?
It's an interesting point. Yeah, because what is the difference between a goat and a sheep
goat
sound?
Goat or more...
right.
More of that.
But that was kind of bah.
Yeah, that was more bah.
Listen, Bruce has never agreed with me on anything, so we're together. Thank God we're unified on this one.
Yeah,
all right, but that was pretty good there, Anderson. And, all right, so.
Where's Dr. True?
Yeah, where is he?
So
anyway, Brewer will be in here on Thursday, and you ready to go back to the phones here?
Well, what's he talk about when he's done doing the, what is he?
I don't know.
His whole shtick.
I know he's done a few movies, and maybe this is just one more of them. All right, so.
First cousins.
Let's go back to the phone. Speak to Bill, who's 33. Bill?
Hey.
Hey.
How you doing, guys?
Good.
I recently married my first cousin, and we're thinking of having kids, and I was just wondering if what sort of tests we have to take or what we have to do to make sure that everything turns out all right.
Now, this first cousin is who? Whose side is she on?
It's on my mom's side.
Your mom's side.
What part of New York are you from?
I'm from the island.
Oh.
And this is your mom's sister's daughter.
Right.
All right. That makes it a first one, right?
Yep, pretty much.
And there's a stigma about about this, but they just tell you that so you don't screw your cousin.
Well, it's
obviously didn't pay any attention to that.
It's because of the problems genetically.
Something that was planned.
It's going to bring out any kind of genetic.
Yeah, but if there's nothing there, there's nothing there, right?
Yeah, there's nothing there, there's nothing there. You tend to have a higher incidence of genetic problems.
Well, I guess, here's what I'm asking you. Let's say you don't possess any genetic problems, and you get together with someone who doesn't possess any genetic problems.
But it's impossible.
How does that work?
It's just impossible to know at this point. As far as I know, they don't have testing that's going to tell you. Because some of these things, they're recessive, and you'd have to map out the whole gene sequence.
But what if you have a family that just has no history of anything like this?
It doesn't matter.
Doesn't matter?
No.
Not better, though, than that a family does have a history?
A lot of these things are sporadic.
Problems?
No, you're still running an increased risk.
Yeah, but it's marginal, right?
No. It's not marginal.
It's a large risk?
No, but if I were Bill, I'd sit down with the family doc or talking to a geneticist would be the best way to get the most current information on something like this, because there's so much research being done with mapping genome.
But he's going to have kids.
Yeah, well.
What are the precautions?
I don't know that there's
anything. There isn't any.
No, other than they might be able to look at their genetic material and come up with more information than was possible in the past.
All right, so you go, now where's he find a geneticist?
Yellow Pages? I don't know.
I'm asking Dr. Bruce.
No.
Thanks, Bill.
Well, no, I mean, he's on Long Island.
You go to a college?
Well, Long Island, where are you from, Long Island? I'm from Long Island, so I know that you're...
Oh, who cares?
Go to you near Stony Brook? Were you closer to the city? Huh?
I can get out there.
Or are you closer to the city?
I'm probably closer to the city.
Okay, well, you got in. You know, just go to like NYU to the School of Medicine, their university hospital. That's one place. I mean, Columbia, any of the university medical centers, they'll have a very active genetics department. And if you can't get a referral from your primary care doc, you're in an area which has tremendous resources for that sort of thing.
Yeah. It's got to be weird when you marry your cousin, you know, and then people you work with, they don't really know, and they come by, and they come over for dinner, and they're sitting around, and they go, where'd you two meet? And you're like, mom's living room in 1963.
Yeah, there's a stigma about it, definitely. But a lot of people don't, you know, give out the information too freely. Keep it sort of quiet.
Well, I spoke to Drew about this once, and Drew did mention that it was a little bit overdone, you know, the kids coming out with the three arms kind of things. And the head that was shaped like a tortoise shell, you know?
It is.
And it's a little overdone.
Right. But there are, I don't know what the legalities are, but in some places I think it's not allowed or...
Yeah, I would say.
New York, possibly.
Yeah, I don't know. Let me ask Bill. Hey, Bill?
Yeah?
Where, you got married, right?
Right.
Did anyone have a problem with this? Did you have to lie about someone's name?
The folks weren't too happy on it about it. Let's just say I'm on the way, way down on the happy list.
With your parents or with her parents?
How old is your first cousin?
She's 11.
She's 38.
38. Okay. All right. That's a little bit weird for the family.
Yeah, we're not going to be invited to Thanksgiving, I think. Something like that.
Yeah. Mm. Well, let me tell you something about pissing off the family. I know a lot of people frown on that and look at it as a long and lonely life. One way, it could be construed as dodging a bullet, too. I mean...
Well, but they're from New York. You know, if this was California, I bet there'd be a lot more acceptance of it. Because, you know...
Do you think so?
I think more, yeah.
Do you think they're less tolerant of this sort of behavior in New York?
Oh, yeah.
Really? They're not so tolerant over here. Mm. We're pretty uptight around here.
Oh. Mm-hmm.
Well, let me just give you an example.
In New York... If a cop is standing around, you can jaywalk directly in front of the cop.
No problem.
And you can do multiple things directly in front of the cop that aren't really crime-driven.
But out here is a big pain in the ass. Like, for instance, I was filming something in New York. I was out on the sidewalk. It was out front of Madison Square Garden. And in L.A., they would have shut you down in a second. Where's your permit? I don't see a permit. They would have hustled you out of there. they're kind of Gestapo-like out here.
Oh, yeah.
And over there, it's like, hey, yo, jack off, get out of here. Get out of here. Move it down there. Now, their whole thing is they do what L.A. cops should do, which is if you're not committing a crime, they're not so interested in you.
Right.
I wish the Los Angeles cops were a little less interested in the people that aren't actually doing anything. Think you guys could preoccupy about the criminals and not the people that don't do stuff? The people that pay the taxes? Maybe we could cut those people some slack. But over here, we're scared of our cops. I don't know why we're scared of our cops, but somehow they figured out in such a way we're all scared of our cops.
Right.
We're scared to drive. We're scared to park. We're scared to do anything because we're either going to get ticket or get our ass kicked. I don't know how this evolved this way.
Appearances out here, appearances are real big. New York is just what's practical, what works.
New York is if you pay taxes and you want to cross the goddamn street and you're a goddamn adult, you get to do it.
But you're also fair game. You put your, once your foot's out off the curb,
sure,
the taxis go after you, I'll tell you that.
But if you're filming something and you're in front of Madison Square Garden, they don't really care whether you have a permit or not. They care if you're holding up traffic. They care if you're causing a nuisance. So they'll just come up to you and go, yeah, film all you want, but when people are walking, clear it out a little bit and give them some space.
Yeah.
L.A., no, they need a permit. When did L.A. turn in? How did we get so goddamn uptight around here with all this stuff?
Everybody wants to be a star. Everybody wants to be important. It's like,
is that what's
going
on?
The people at the concerts with those laminates. That's my other gripe.
Yeah, I really, I'll tell you, I traveled through Europe just recently. I haven't had a chance to talk about it too much because we had guests, and then I wasn't here, and then Drew wasn't here, and all this kind of stuff. But Europe is nice because they treat the adults like adults. It's kind of nice. If you want to walk down the street with a beer in your hand, if you don't not wearing a lampshade on your head and raping somebody, you get to do it. You get to do stuff that adults do over there.
Right.
You want to have a cigarette? You get to have a cigarette. You want to have a beer? You get to have a beer. You want to cross the street and there's no crosswalk? You get to cross the street. You find an open parking space? You get to park in it. Doesn't matter if the bumper's hanging on over into something. There's no goddamn parking meters and there's no red painted on any curbs or anything like that. You just get to like park and walk and smoke and drink and do all those other things that responsible adults are allowed to do in other countries. Except for here, if I park my car in front of my own goddamn garage and it's facing the wrong direction, I get a ticket. And if I go down to get the goddamn newspaper and I'm holding a beer, I'll get wrestled to the ground. Now what the hell is that? And who decided this was okay?
It's because in Europe, people don't take advantage of the simple privileges.
And I'm tired of this excuse of, well, one guy gets out of line, and so now nobody can. F that. Then you punish that one guy. You don't punish society constantly. I'm tired of being scared of the cops in this town. I'm tired of, I don't know what it's like in your town if you're listening, but I'll tell you, L.A. just, the cops are horrible. The whole city's horrible with that stuff. The parking enforcement, the cops, no place worse than Burbank or Rape Bank, as I like to call it. All they do is rape their citizens. They squeeze money from everybody in town. Stop. Leave everyone alone. Let the people go to work, you jackasses. Pussies. Just do your job. And you know what your job is? Your job's what we tell you to do. I don't give a rat's ass about a guy smoking and he's closer than 10 feet from the opening of a building. Or some guy wants to drink a beer. It's his business. Leave him alone. Stop with the jaywalking and all the other nonsense. Stop nickel and diming everybody. You get back to work. You bust criminals.
You
do what they do in Europe. And all you pussies with your cities, with your goddamn, you got them parking meters every 8 feet. Your parking enforcement guys running around everywhere. Jesus Christ. In Europe, you just park. There's an open parking spot. You get to park in it like a human being. You know, they park on corners.
Yep.
They park on corners because it's an open space. It's not obstructing anything. And it keeps things moving. Why can't we park anywhere in this town?
People take advantage of things over here. People are always looking for an angle.
Oh,
in Europe,
my God.
They just mind their own business.
They tow. All they do is tow out here in Los Angeles, too. I didn't see one goddamn tow truck in all of Europe. Here, they're just towing everybody all the time. Everyone's getting towed. Everyone's getting fined. Stop raping everybody. Just get back to work, you pussies.
Okay.
You're going
to have a heart attack. You have a stroke.
I've had an ass full of these people, and your signals that turn red. I mean, your arrows, your red arrows everywhere. Kiss my ass. I drive right through them every time. I drive through 100 of them in Culver City every goddamn night, and I laugh like a maniac. Write me a ticket. I don't care.
You need to
pay it and laugh.
You're in Amsterdam. Amsterdam would...
Jesus Christ, what is wrong with this city? It drives me nuts. Not a parking meter, not a parking enforcement guy, no paint on any curb of any kind. And let me say this. In Paris, for instance, they understand that there's a certain aesthetic quality to their city. That they don't want red paint all over all the curbs. That they don't want parking meters every 8 feet. They don't want some jackass driving around in his parking enforcement cushman busting everybody all the time. They let people sort of walk around and live a little bit. What's your problem?
My problem? I found Paris, people did not like Americans. Paris, if you didn't speak French,
I wouldn't like us either. We're idiots with that stupid parking and everything.
Okay.
No, I had no problems in Paris.
Really?
People were nice. People were friendly, and you get to sit out on the curb and have a beer if you want, like an adult.
Mm-hmm.
They let you do what you want to do. You can walk around. You can park. You can drive. You can move. You don't have people yelling at you all the time. Go out there. Here, you smoke a cigarette, you can't even smoke out front of a building. You got to go down the street and stuff. You can't smoke in a park.
No?
No. Oh. They just let you live over there. Why don't we do that? We can't let people live here. We got to write tickets for everything. Brian?
Hey.
21, what's up?
Hey, it's an honor to talk to the new BK Value Menu.
Yeah. What's up there, Brian?
Hey, I hear you talking about your cars and your houses all the time.
Mm-hmm.
And I was wondering why you haven't been on Cribs yet. On MTV.
Well, let me say this about
those are all
MTV.
Rented houses. At least you own your own houses.
Yeah.
Those guys, half those things, I think they rent.
Well, here's the thing. A couple of feelings on MTV's Cribs. One is, where does a 16-year-old rapper who I've never heard of in my entire life get a $280,000 Bentley? Do you know what I'm saying?
Oh, yeah.
Like, he opens the garage, he's got the Bentley that's parked next to the Ferrari 360 Modena, and then he's got the vet over here, and the kid literally has $450,000 worth of cars, and I'm looking at the guy and I'm going, I don't think I know this guy's face. I'm not sure if I've seen him anywhere before. They must get these cars and just lease them for the day or lease them for the month or move them back and forth.
That's what the rumor is.
It would seem with the cars. Now, the houses are usually out in some state where 400 grand gets you a nice spread.
Right.
400 grand out here gets you a plaster box in Van Nuys that you get to go to and die if you play your cards right at after about 30 years.
Yeah.
Over there, they get these places. They're somewhere in Florida. It costs 458 grand. It's got a circular driveway and a pool that's the shape of a microphone. But anyway, I will not be on MTV because... MTV didn't want me on MTV when I was on MTV.
Oh.
So I'm not so sure they would want me on now. And I'd really not want to do that. I think it's kind of weird bringing the camera crew into your house.
Well, I just want to see your bidet toilet seat and your hamper.
Oh, okay. Yeah, the toilet seat just looks like a toilet seat for your grandparents.
Okay.
It looks like something out of a hospital.
That's why you want him to be on Cribs, huh?
I just think it would be funny. He comes to the door with his eye shade on, having just napped.
Yeah, yeah.
And, brings him through, shows him the urinals and the hamper where you disposed of your gym socks.
Well, Dr. Bruce has been to my homes.
Ah, I think that angled television, that is one of the most ingenious aspects. And
get the TV up on the ceiling.
Well, with your homes, the interesting thing is your touch has gone into these homes, and you've done a lot of the work there. So that's what, I mean, it would be the most unique visit on an MTV crib show because...
Really? Think so?
Oh, yeah. Well,
because I built the houses.
Oh, especially
for
the Hollywood
part.
One. That was a fascinating tour that I got of that house. I mean, the work you did in that house. The fireplace, we found that book on...
Oh, yes. Bruce brought me over a book on custom fireplaces from the 20s, and it turned out I had one. But let's not bore the people with that. I think it's weird when you bring a camera crew in your house
and
you show them every room in your house, and then they film the outside of the house and stuff, and then they leave. I don't know. Doesn't it sort of seem like you're asking for trouble a little bit in this day and age? Feels a little bit weird. well, to me.
In L.A., the cops might then have more of an idea. Knowing your diatribe, they know where you lived, and they'd go paint red lines on the curb outside your house, and then you couldn't park there.
No, they'd get me for jaywalking across my living room without paying them. Hmm. Can we just pay the cops a certain amount each year, and they can just leave us alone? Is that like a little hush money or something?
Oh.
A little payola? Something just to keep them busy?
They'd never accept that.
Yeah, they'd rather just get it $35 at a time.
Yeah.
Lisa, you're 21. What's up?
My question is for Dr. Bruce. My boyfriend wants to have anal sex, and I'm not sure that I want to.
Mm-hmm.
And I was wondering if, two questions, if there's any way to make it more enjoyable, and what are the dangers of having anal sex?
Well, you can get ripping and bleeding, and those amyl poppers will make it more enjoyable. You know,
to make you feel like your head's going to explode.
Amyl nitrate?
Yeah.
Is that what it's called?
Yeah.
Thank you. And you just pop those things?
You're the ones they sell in all the whatever
shops. Gays love them.
Yeah. Okay, what Adam said is absolutely true. The anal sphincter, you know, this is muscle, and when especially you're not exactly anticipating a pleasurable experience, you tend to tighten down that muscle. And if something's forced in there, it's very easy to cause tears. And then the further up you go, the more serious a tear would be. So placing a foreign or non-foreign object in the anal sphincter can be not very pleasurable, and it can be dangerous in terms of causing bleeding and tearing. Right.
But,
so,
but let's talk about the most practical way to do this. If
get
in fact
drunk
somebody wants to do it.
And get Astroglide.
I
had anal sex and I passed out a couple of times.
Yeah, that can happen too. That's stimulating that area can cause a vasovagal response, which
we heard the clip, we know.
Yeah, it slow your heart down. It's just like when somebody sees blood, it's the same neuronal pathway where your heart slows down to the point where you pass out. So that area is famous for that.
Okay, so you get, let's talk about booze for a second.
Well,
you use lubricant.
Yeah.
And if you're, let's say, tense.
Oh, you got to have
glass
some
of wine.
Well, what, you know, I mean what does Drew say? I've heard Drew talk about the I hate to tell somebody to get drunk, but
no,
basically
but,
you're going to have to get that much.
A glass of wine is not getting drunk. It sometimes just relaxes you. What's that?
More like a bottle of tequila.
Yeah.
Yeah, really. I mean, a glass of wine, if you're not into this experience, it's not something you want to do. You know, if your boyfriend can't be satisfied with some other form of sexual gratification, it's just something that generally both partners need to really agree on, and the receiving end, so to speak.
Right. All right. Well, listen, here's the bottom line. If you don't
want to do it.
She doesn't
sound like she wants to do it.
All right. If you don't want to do it, don't do it. But for those of our listeners who are thinking about it and would like to do it, the lubrication, a little glass of wine, loosen you up a little or calm you down. And anything else, Bruce? Hot bath?
Take a little Vicodin tonight, take some codeine, smoke a little heroin.
Right.
Yeah.
So Bruce is Drew says the cocktail of heroin, Vicodin, and codeine.
That might work, but I don't think Drew would recommend that either.
Well, I just heard him. We'll take a little break. We'll be right back.
Hello? Is this LoveLine?
Call 1-800-LOVE-191. Adam and Dr. Drew will be right back.
Does it go in the butt?
Buddy, LoveLine. I'm Adam. That's Dr. Bruce filling in for Dr. Drew. Dr. Drew in here tomorrow night. And let's hop back to the phones.
Well, here's an anal sex follow-up. Sounds pretty funny.
All right. Do a little anal following. Mindy?
Yes?
You're 36?
I am.
What's up?
I want to know why guys like anal sex so much and how, I don't know. What do you do to tell them flat out, no, this is never going to happen, and convince them that that's the way it is?
All right. Well, a couple of things. I'm going to, and Bruce, you tell me what the percentage is, and you tell me what you think. I believe that less than 15% of sexually active males are into anal sex.
Right.
Maybe.
I think I've met all 15% then.
Well, there's a certain breed of cat who enjoys that, and you may be with that breed of cat. And that breed of cat is usually guys a little more aggressive and usually has some issues with women. Now, there are certain guys who just like anal sex. They like the sensation of it. And there's certain women who just like it and like the sensation of it. But most of the guys who are really in anal sex are sort of misogynistic guys.
Right.
And it's more of a, more the symbolism than it is the actual sensation.
Really?
Well, sure. You do the math. I mean, okay. They like the idea that there's a little pain involved for the woman and that maybe it's something she doesn't want to do.
And the women that really like it, there tends to have been some abuse in the past. There's something else going on. The other things I've noticed, it seems that with the more common abuse of stimulants, especially methamphetamine, guys tend to get into more, say, unusual sexual acting out, and the anal sex seems to become sort of a fixation for some of these guys. And then I think also with the media, with porn, a lot of porn is... The guys see that, and it's like, oh, I got to do that with my
Yeah, head. And here's the thing. It doesn't mean you're a maniac if you've tried it or done it a handful of times or whatever. But if it's kind of your forte, maybe there's some issues.
Yeah,
there.
Yeah. When a guy, it's like, that's...
Well, I'm getting divorced over it.
You're getting divorced over the anal?
Yeah.
What happened?
Basically, I said no over a long period of time. And truly only a handful of times that he pushed the issue, but the last time he pushed the issue, I said, you know what, 3 times and you're out. I said no, I meant no, bye-bye.
Well, there's got to be a lot of other stuff in your relationship that wasn't right.
There is more other stuff that's not right, but it does center around this borderline behavior.
Yeah, you know, it's funny.
It centers around this, you say, here's the line, don't cross it, and we cross it. And what I felt like was every time I got comfortable sexually with him, which obviously after 10 years I did at some point, that's when he would take the opportunity to go, oh, well, she's comfortable, let's try this again, and without any communication verbally at
What's
all.
What's happened with you with anal sex in the past? Anything else?
Oh, I was raped.
Shocking.
Yeah, I know, you're shocked, aren't you?
And he knows, and he knew that.
Oh, clearly, yeah. Huge. Yeah.
All right, so listen, he's got issues.
Not the most sensitive guy in the world.
You got issues, too.
Yeah.
Did he ever do any drugs, or...?
No, alcohol. Alcohol's a big deal.
Okay, well.
I don't want to call any of it abusive as much as I want to call it borderline behaviors, because it's like...
Dry anal rape. Yeah, sorry, go ahead.
What'd you say?
Dry anal rape. A porn star told me that happened to her one time.
Oof.
Yeah, so, wait a minute. Are you sober now?
Oh, I am. I don't have any problems with drugs or alcohol.
And what'd your dad do to you growing up?
Oh, from the time I was 3 to the time I was 16.
3 to 16.
Mm-hmm. My earliest memories include that, and I was asked to leave the house when I was 16.
Yeah. That's horrible.
Mm-hmm. You get over it. I mean, you know.
No, you don't. Not really. I mean,
no.
you work with it.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, listen.
I'm a competent, normal adult. And,
right.
And I'm clear about lines for me.
Yeah, I know, but you end up hooking up with guys like this and getting freaked out over anal sex.
Well,
that's
the problem that it causes.
Yeah,
so
but
are there normal guys out there that don't do this?
Yeah, it's just you're going to have trouble finding them because of what your dad did to you.
Why?
Well, part of the reason I like your dad killed is not only because of what he did to you 20 years ago, but what he continues to do to you through your choices in men and relationships and that kind of stuff as an adult.
Yeah, and until you... Have you
See
gotten
what
I'm
in, saying?
You'll attract guys like that, is what it amounts to.
Until I what?
You will attract guys like that.
Okay, when do I stop attracting guys like that?
Have you been in therapy around this issue? Have you really...
I was in therapy before I met him, yeah.
Well, but now you have more experience to base it on and more to discuss with a therapist in terms of what went on in a relationship with a guy that tends to do that, and how do you act, or how did you participate in being in that relationship?
Now, here's the thing, Mindy. Unfortunately, in my eyes, because of what your dad did to you over that course of time, this is pretty much requires therapy for the rest of your life. Once a week, no big deal. You know what I mean? Couldn't hurt anyway, even if your dad didn't do this to you. I mean, I go to a therapist. My dad only symbolically raped me. Symbolically.
Symbolically.
Yeah, if he was more of a man, he would have really done it in person. But he symbolically did it.
Uh-oh.
By, you know, not buying me windbreakers with team names on and things like that. But you should get back into therapy.
But on the contrary, it's not going to be for the rest of your life. And what
on
some,
the contrary.
On the,
hold on a second.
Mistake some people make.
Yeah, see,
because you went through therapy early on or before this relationship doesn't mean that you dealt with these issues, and it doesn't mean that going to therapy now wouldn't really be successful because you have more history, you have more of the outcome of what the trauma was to talk to the therapist about.
Well,
and you're more mature.
Hold on a second.
How's come that's on the contrary?
Because it's focused, goal-oriented. 6 months in therapy and you're out of there. A good therapist is going to say, I want to deal with this issue with you. I want to get you out of here in 6 months.
Well, she has an issue involving sex that is one of the issues that was caused from her abuse at the hands of her father from age, being raped by her dad from 3 to 16. Your dad's having sexual intercourse with you starting at 3 and stopping at 16. That's a lifetime of therapy. It just is. Now, you can go in 6 months at a time and get out for 6 months. You better stay around it.
Yeah, I just hate to tell people this is a lifetime of therapy sounds like more like psychoanalysis, which is a totally different.
No, but I mean, you treat it like exercise. It's a part of what you do to stay healthy.
If she can just work on identifying what it is that attracts her to and attracts other people to, the victim in her, and get into a healthier relationship and form new ways of. And
but dad had intercourse with her for 12 years.
Well, it doesn't make you a sexual and a relationship cripple. And that's what people need to hear, that there is hope. You sound a little hopeless, and I've seen a lot of people really change courses in life.
You can have a good life.
I'm not that hopeless.
No, I'm just saying.
But don't say, I've been to therapy 10
years. You feel like a sexual cripple. That was an interesting way you said that.
Right.
I feel like I'm, you know, all the things I do in my life and the different jobs I have and things, I'm definitely on top of my game as far as my sanity. I've got two kids I'm bringing to the world. Life is fine. And we went to a marriage counselor.
No.
The marriage counselor said, you know, Mike, she drew the line at here, and you crossed it by, you know, and so I didn't play the victim. I didn't allow that to happen. I said, okay, here's the line, and we're going to stop now. And when he didn't, those are the consequences.
All right. But look, we know that part. I'm just saying get back into therapy because of being raped by your father for all those years, and the fact that
you're a lot different today. She's 36 years old at this point. That's she can really make some changes that she couldn't have made 10 years
for the sake of your kids. And you do sound remarkably sane considering.
Absolutely,
this is what happened. And really, I hope her dad's dead. Where's your dad? Is he dead?
No, as a matter of fact, I still take care of him quite a bit.
Where's he live? In Florida somewhere?
No, he lives in Phoenix.
Aha. Why do you take care of him?
One, I'm adopted, and so I'm not blood related to that family. That's a good thing.
Right.
Two, you know, being mad at him and punishing him and doing all those things doesn't do me any good.
Yeah.
He's the only grandparent my child. Well, my mom was alive. She's dead now. They're the only grandparents my kids will ever know. So
Just don't leave him alone with them.
Never. And they knew that when my first baby was born. I said, get two rules, and these are the things that will never happen. And they never crossed those lines. And so as long as they didn't cross him, they could see him.
And my brother is a
drug addict, and he's living at home. And so when dad says, hey, I need something or whatever, I do what I can to the extent that I can. And here's the line. Don't cross it.
He had sex with you from the time you were 4 until the time you were 16?
True.
And
was it reported?
When I was 16, Child Protective Services came to the house, and my parents, well, my mom tossed me. Basically, I was old enough at that point that they said, you know, she can do whatever she wants. She could run. She, you know.
Did your mom?
They basically can't. No, my mom believed him at that point. Well, actually, she blamed me for what happened.
Does she believe?
Well, that's classic.
Yeah, and she believe him now or you now or?
She was basically nuts and severely ill. And, you know, at some point, once I was on my own, the reason I left was I was the strongest one to leave.
Yeah, all right. But listen.
And once I left, I let the crazy people
Minnie,
live on their own.
Minnie,
yes.
Do not be scared to punish. Do not be scared at all. Zero problem with that. I want to live in that society.
Mm-hmm.
I want people to be punished.
Well, he should be registered. This guy should be registered, and there are consequences for what he did, and I'm not sure he got them.
Well,
he should be punished, absolutely.
And listen, everybody, if a guy who adopts you, there's no blood there, and he's having sex with you from age 3 to age 16, it's okay to be mad at him for the rest of your life, and it's okay to punish him.
Yeah.
And there's zero problem with that. It's like, look, guy kills the little neighbor girl, we send him to the chair.
We should send him to the
chair. I have zero problem with that.
Zero problem.
Well, here's my question. You want to live in a society where a guy does that and it's okay? I mean, people are like, all right, he did a bad thing, but let's leave the guy alone. Doesn't do us any good. Sure, it does us some good. I'm fine with that. We need to be. That's the way we need to be. You rape and kill a little 5-year-old girl, we kill you. That's fine. I don't care if it makes anyone feel better.
How could I not go and personally take it into my own hands and do something to that person? I mean, for my daughter. I can't imagine a society that would not do that, not send that message by, like, if this guy doesn't get the death penalty, I'd be
You'd want
very
to kill
disappointed.
Him. Yeah, well, he did get the death penalty.
Okay, I missed the news today.
The Van Damme guy?
Yeah.
He got the death penalty. But that just means he can hover around for 10 years before we kill him.
Yeah.
And he can get married and have conjugal visits and have kids when he's in the can.
On death row?
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. But Ted Bundy had a kid. Tex Watkins had a kid.
Well, I'm not saying I feel like going out and killing him, but I'm saying if it were my daughter,
on death row.
Those emotions are very easy to understand.
I don't know about the Menendez boys. I think they got married. I don't know if they have kids. And by the way, these are the guys I want out.
Yeah.
I want the Menendez brothers out. You decide it's a good idea to kill your parents, they had it coming.
They're not getting out anytime soon.
I'd like to see them get out. Lyle and what the hell's the guy's name? Eric, if you're listening from your small FM receiver in the joint, I'd like to see you get out. I personally would.
I'm not asking why.
And I was doing, I killed his parents. I figured they had it coming.
Okay.
Oh, just listen, Bruce. If somebody said to you, imagine if your two kids got together and they said, one of them said to the other one, hey, why don't we kill Bruce with a shotgun? And the other one went, all right. Okay, that seems like a good plan. You think maybe you did something wrong as a parent?
Well, there was some, sodomy implied there, but I don't know if that would...
Nature or nurture. Your own kids decide it'd be a good idea to snuff you out, and two of them get together and agree on it, and then decide we should take mom too?
There's some bad blood or bad genetics.
But that's just, hey, that's a domestic issue. I don't care. You start screwing with someone in society, I got a problem with that. You want to kill your parents, that's your problem.
Well, I don't agree, but I see your point.
All right. I'm just saying, not nearly as dangerous a guy as a guy who goes to the trailer across the street and rapes and kills some girl.
Right. Oh, absolutely.
That's what I'm saying.
Or a child. I mean, that's these guys.
I mean, you get the feeling these Menendez boys, they get out of prison and probably never do anything else.
Yeah. But even in the New Testament, Christ even said, to do this unto a child, you may as well have a weight tied to your ankle and be thrown in the deepest ocean. So, sounds pretty radical.
So we ought to do that then, right? And by the way, that whole chuck him in the ocean thing is not a bad plan.
No, with a heavy weight on the ankle.
Well, see, look at it this way. We got to do that whole walk into the place. We got to strap them down. We give them the lethal injection and all the thing. And then when we're done with them, we got to unstrap them, and we got to have a doctor monitor them, and then we got to put them in a basket.
We
got to bury them. There's an ambulance ride. This is just a short trip offshore. Just drop them right in the water.
Yeah. And that's...
be nice. All right.
Let's Christian solution.
Let's take a... it's going to be the name of my band.
Final solution.
We're going to take a little break. When we come back, we'll speak to AJ. Let's know how he can initiate girlfriend to go down on him. A little peanut butter.
She won't
works for
that.
Me, but we'll figure this out after this.
Loveline.
1-800-LOVE-191.
We'll be right back.
Thank you.
Hey, everybody, Loveline. I'm Adam. That is Dr. Bruce filling in for Dr. Drew. He's back tomorrow night. Back to the phones. Hey, Bruce?
Yeah.
Yeah?
The phones.
All right. AJ.
Yeah.
17.
Hey, what's up? All right, I've been going on with this girl for, like, 3 months, right? And, like, we've had sex or whatever. But I just, like, I wanted your output on how I should initiate her to go down on me. Like, she doesn't want to. You know, I've gone down on her, but... Mm-hmm.
Did he say output?
What'd you say?
Your output on it.
Right.
Yeah, like, input. What should I do? I mean, I don't want to force her head down there.
I think output is when you make number two. Right. You want our input on it.
Yeah, your input.
That's right. All right.
Output actually makes more sense, though.
Because you should be asking for my output to go into your input.
I've never thought of it before.
Yeah. I will, on occasion, put my output in a dude's input. Usually, like, I used to, you know, when I was a little short on cash, when I was, you know, late on cash. Hey, AJ?
Yeah.
It's hard to get her to do stuff that she doesn't want to do, but there's two reasons why women don't do things sexually, and you got to figure out what they are, especially oral sex. Oh, here's the reasons, and here's what we have to figure out. She could not be going down on you because her dad did something horrible to her and made her go down on him, and now she's freaked out on it, something like that. Some trauma.
Right.
Could
right.
be number one. Not likely, but that's possibly one of them. Number two is she's just sort of freaked out by it because certain percentage of women are just sort of freaked out by that, not really into that. There's a percentage that are and a percentage that aren't. And the third, and what is probably the most likely is she's a little nervous. She doesn't think she's going to be very good at it. And she's kind of avoiding it because she thinks she's going to screw it up somehow. Or not do a good job with it. How old is she?
She's 17, too.
17.
Yeah.
Does she have... What's her family like?
Her family... Well, her dad's kind of like... Her dad, like, locks her in the house a lot. She's not really allowed out much or anything, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So...
Because she's gotten in trouble in the past, or they're just...
Yeah, I mean, she's had some bad experiences in the past that she's gotten caught by her parents by, like, sexual things.
Like the football team, doing the football team?
Oh, not...
Not no, exactly.
Soccer.
You know, yeah. And the other, are you circumcised?
Yeah.
Okay. And your hygiene's good. I mean, you're real clean and everything.
Right, yeah.
But, you know, it's okay, 17, you're not really an adult yet. And for a female, you know, there are a lot of things sexually that people aren't ready for at 17. And she may just not be ready for it. She just doesn't, I mean, there's nothing you can do to change situations like that.
Yeah. Right.
Okay,
it's something you gotta have, though, you know?
Yeah.
What's that?
It's something you gotta have, though. I mean,
you gotta have.
I have. Well, any guy does, right?
No, no.
Bruce doesn't have to have it.
No, no. You know, sex is not a recreational sport.
Whoa.
Okay? And it's not like you have a menu here and you read the menu and it's like I can have any of these things.
Yeah.
It's supposed to be a product of intimacy and love, and it's when someone's ready for it. And in some relationships, the other person may just choose not to do that. I mean, not everybody has to have every form of sex that they can conjure
up. Okay, but here's the thing. If you want something and your partner doesn't seem to want to do it, it's all right to have the discussion about it.
But would you agree that at age 17, I think it has more to do with what I, you know, almost bragging rights. I mean, at 17, I have to have oral sex for my girlfriend. I can't.
No, you don't have to. Be nice. Billy? Billy, you're 17.
Yep.
You,
awake?
Doctor said you have herpes A.
Well, actually, yeah.
Type 1, you mean?
Yeah. I went to the, after I had, like, it was a year ago, and I had a party at my house, you know, parents weren't there, and, you know, had the keg and alcohol and everything, and, you know, I had too much to drink, and it was real late, it was like 3 o'clock, and I, like, slept with this girl that, at the time, I didn't know had a bad reputation. Like, been with, like, almost every guy, and unfortunately, I, like, didn't know. So, a couple weeks went by, and I started getting, like, this itchy feeling in the back of my throat. And I just, like, rubbed it off. I didn't think it was really anything until it got, like, so bad, like, I couldn't breathe, and I couldn't eat or drink anything. So, as soon as that happened, I went to the emergency room, and they said that it was a type of herpes, like, herpes A. And they're really... The only thing the doctor gave me was, like, a naval remedy. It was a combination of Mylanta and Benadryl. I had to gargle that for like a, like 10 minutes.
Navel remedy?
Nasal remedy. Okay.
Okay.
So maybe it was Coxsackie A, which, you know, herpes, the herpes virus family is just, there's a large number of viruses. And if you have certain kind of sores in your throat or your mouth, they're typically viral. And Mylanta and Benadryl. Benadryl is an antihistamine, but it turns out it's an excellent local anesthetic. If somebody's allergic to lidocaine, which they, you know, give you an injection to sew you up, you can inject somebody with Benadryl and it numbs your skin just like, you know, xylocaine or lidocaine would. So they give you the Mylanta as a soothing thing and the Benadryl to numb those so you can at least, you know, eat and swallow.
What's the Mylanta do?
It's just a coating agent.
Oh, it is.
And then the Benadryl's in there, and so it coats it and soothes it, and the Benadryl actually numbs it. So Benadryl, even though it's an antihistamine and people take it,
right,
when you actually put it on a mucous membrane or you get the liquid and inject it, which if somebody's allergic to lidocaine, which you use to, you can sew somebody up with it. So what, it's an anesthetic and a coating.
What's he need to do now?
I'm not sure. What was his question?
Though? Well, I don't know. I guess he was kind of saying that
if it's herpes and he has oral sex, but that's... Hello?
Yeah. Actually, I found out, like, from my one of my best friends, his dad is like, you know, he like knows a lot about this, and he said that it probably like didn't even come from her because I didn't have oral sex with her.
No, it actually sounds more like a Coxsackie virus, which I believe is a type of, in the herpes family. But cold sores are herpes type 1, and the genital herpes is type 2. It's herpes simplex type 1 and type 2. And the typical question we get here, can you get the one from your mouth area on your genitals? And yes, you can, but it's not as common. But anytime you have the little sores on your mouth, the herpes type 1, you can get it if you have oral sex.
Hey,
they can go both ways.
Good times.
Bruce,
yeah.
did you make up Coxsackie, or is that real?
No, that's real.
Coxsackie.
Yep.
Yeah.
C-O-X.
It's great.
Hey, there's a good drop, a dew drop.
Imagine if you had, like, the Coxsackie virus and you lived up at Lake Titicaca or something.
Great comedy stuff.
Your name was, like, Dick Ballman.
Dick Hurt. Who's
imagine Dick Hurt? If Dick Butkus moved to Lake Titicaca and got the Ballsackie virus. Coxsackie virus. Yeah, that'd be funny. Let's take a little break here, Bruce. What do you say?
Yeah, because it's
nice. All right. We'll be right back.
Okay, so I know there's nothing wrong with me. So what's up?
So I was like you, and I used to think that these datelines were totally cheesy.
Why can't I meet anybody?
But I tried everything else and thought, what the hell? So I called the dateline and actually met a cool guy.
I called the dateline and I hooked up with some cool people.
Believe it or not, other normal people are out there looking too.
877-889-DATE.
LoveLine. 1-800-LOVE-191.
We'll be right back.
Everybody, that's the show. I want to thank Dr. Bruce for coming in here. He had a nice handful of hair gel. He brought me a large coffee.
Good times for everybody.
And, you know, maybe it's just me, but I noticed the Bruce with the hair gel and the Bruce without the hair gel. And it's like Batman without his utility belt. When Bruce does not have that hair gel, he's Clark Kent and Superman. See what I'm saying?
Yeah, it's like you and your hat. I like you. You know, no hat the last couple nights.
Oh, you know, I wanted to ask you about that. I always talk off the air about that.
Okay.
Because, you know, I wear my baseball cap tight around the top of my head, and it pulls all that, and I started looking at my hair, and I was realizing it's
circulation.
It's falling out right in the one spot where it's really tight.
Yeah.
So I decided I should take it off.
Well, from an aesthetic viewpoint, I think I'd keep it on.
Thanks, buddy. Yeah,
anytime.
So until next time, this is Adam Carolla for Dr. Bruce. No?
Don't push the button.
I'm not going to push the button.
I see your hand touching the button.
You see this hand up here? Yeah, I did put my hand over the button, but you see the other hand?
He's going to switch it to his middle finger.
Dr. Bruce for Dr. Saying mahalo.
You know, sex is not a recreational sport.
This has been Loveline.
The opinions expressed on this show are not necessarily those of the staff, management, sponsors, or this station.
The producer for Loveline is Ann Wilkins Engel. Loveline is a presentation of Westwood One Entertainment.